First of all, I want somebody to read that jaw-breaking title for me. It's deliberate. The title, I myself didn't understand what title I had for you. But that was deliberate because it shows the culture of the university as I want to portray it. Can somebody please read the title for me, please?
The Culture of the University and Politics of Educational Borderlands. Participatory research as a dialogue for redefining the other in university-community relations.
Yes, I could have simply said, how do you do research with communities when you are a university researcher? That could have been the title that I should have used. But if I did that, that wouldn't be university. That wouldn't be academic. It wouldn't be scholarly. So I deliberately made it confusing because when it's simple and it's easy and understandable, it's not good enough for a university. It has to be complex. So I start with my personal and cultural introduction. Actually, I'm from Ghana. Originally, I was born in Ghana. I attended school in Ghana, elementary school up to university. My first degree was in economics at the University of Cape Coast in Ghana. And then in 1987, when I was a very young man, young, handsome man, I left Ghana to study in Canada. Actually, what was supposed to be a two-year master's program turned into 24 years of hard labor. And so I don't know how it happened, but I did my master's in Canada, and then after my master's program, I was employed up north in Aboriginal communities. Now we are seeing how everything is coming together. I was a teacher there, and after the first semester, I was made a principal of the school. So I continued being there for only 2 years because I thought it wasn't easy to work in those communities under the situation that I was in. So I decided to go for a PhD. So I went to the University of British Columbia, which we call UBC, where I had my PhD. So whilst I was in UBC, I was very lucky to take a course from a professor called Dr. Bud Hall. Bud Hall was in University Ontario Institute of Studies of Education in Toronto, University of Toronto. He came to teach us a summer course in participatory research. That was my second year in the PhD program. And after I took this course, I said, I won't do anything else. I'm going to do participatory research with the northern communities where I was principal for 2 years. So what I did was to write applications to teach in the communities somewhere, because without being in a position of authority somehow, it would be very difficult to do research there. It wouldn't be participatory. So what I did was wrote applications, and I was told that, well, we don't have a teaching position for you. To the school, same school board that I was with, but we have a principal's position for you. If you want to come back, by then I was at UBC for 2 years, so I finished what they call your residency then, so I could go up north for my research. So I left for, before I left for the north, I told my professor, Dr. Robinson, and supervisors, those people who were supposed to be supervising me, that I was going to do participatory research. And the answer is, Seth, nobody does this kind of thing at UBC. This is UBC. If you don't know where you are, find out where you are. We don't do that kind of research here. And I said, why? If you don't do that kind of research, then I can go somewhere else. All I want to do is to do research that is useful to some people that I know. So if you are not going to accept that kind of research, then I was leaving the university. So my supervisors said, okay, four of them, Dr. Robinson, Dr. Wilinski, who is now Professor Wilinski, who is now in Stanford, they were my supervisors. They said, Seth, you know what? And Dr. Kelsey, an Englishman, they said, you know what we want to do for you? Write a proposal. and come and defend it in front of us. But we don't accept this kind of participatory thing at UBC. So you might be the first person if you defend your proposal properly. So I wrote the proposal and then defended it for a couple of hours in front of these august academicians who wanted to know exactly why I wanted to do participatory research. And they asked me to go out for a while. They called me back and said, okay, you are going to be the first one. Let's see. You are an experiment. Let's see how it goes. We don't do that kind of thing, UBC. So I went up north. I was living with Aboriginal people for 3 years as school principal, living in the community continuously for 3 years, behaving as if I were one of them and doing things with them and just living their lifestyle. So I did this for 3 years, and it was time for me to defend my thesis in 1995. You know what my professors did? They sent my thesis to the biggest name in Canada in bilingual education, Dr. Jim Cummings of University of Toronto, OIZ. And if Jim Cummings, they were sure that Jim Cummings of University of Toronto was not going to accept any of that kind of research, because it was University of Toronto, University of British Columbia. So Jim Cummings read my thesis, sent his report, and I'll come to there. But in the end, Jim Cummings, what did he say? Let me see, I think I have it, the second or third slide. Jim Cummings said, I'll come back to this. Okay, this is Jim Cummings' report. I mean, I copied it from my report. He said, can somebody read that for us, please? I don't want to be talking
about it. An excellent example of participatory research on one of the most pressing problems of Canadian education. I would appreciate it if the dissertation committee would convey my appreciation to the candidate for a well-written, thoughtful, and very significant dissertation study.
Okay, so Jim Cummings made them offer me distinction. I was one of the first people to do a qualitative research in UBC to be offered a distinction for dissertation. So I got a distinction, something they call category one. So when I came out of the defense, it took me 4 hours to defend my thesis, 4 hours. When I came out of the defense, everybody was asking me, did you make a third? A third means a pass. Did you make a third? People saw me the next day, and I told them, I made a first distinction, you know? So it was surprising to everybody, how could he do participatory research and have a distinction? So the interesting thing is that after this Jim Cummings report and my participatory research success, I became a legend at UBC. And in fact, my thesis is one of the pieces that has been oversighted in Aboriginal education of late. The University of Tempe in Arizona has designated it at one time as one of the most oversighted theses since 1996. That was the time that it came out. And papers that were published from the thesis are constantly being used as conceptual frameworks for Aboriginal studies all over the world, not only in Canada, but in Australia and other places. And so the issue is that I am here now trying to somehow talk about Aboriginal research, but you know what? My story, my cultural and personal introduction, just tells us about what Palmer says about university culture. That is, now we are coming back to the title of my presentation, the culture of the university. The Aboriginal communities that I was supposed to go to, they are others. They are not the educational borderlands. We don't work with them. We study them and tell the story in our own way. They are not supposed to be part of the story anymore after we have gone to them. Okay, can Marion, can you read this for us, please? Do you have your glasses?
Yes. Academic culture holds disconnection as a virtue. Intellectually, the academy is committed to an epistemology, a way of knowing which claims that if you don't disconnect yourself from the object of study, whether it's an episode in history or a body of literature or a phenomenon of the natural world, your knowledge of it will not be valid. For a century and more, we have venerated detached scholarship, while disciplines that require close encounters between the knower and the known, art, music, dance, and the like, have been pushed to the bottom of the academic totem pole.
Yes, in the UK, when they are cutting budgets, you know, for schools, if dance, they cut dance, right? They cut music, they cut even physical education. And yet, we pay more for sports here. The sports people here in this country are the richest people in the world, but these are the very things that we love to hate. This is how academia is this way, that when it's good, when it's easy, it's admired, it's appreciated, it's not good enough. But when it's very difficult, you can't understand my title. That means a good presentation. If my title is very easy and straightforward, it means it's not good enough. It's not academic at all. So this is how it is. And Palmer talks about it very well. And then going to the communities, Aboriginal communities, to study, my professors at UBC did not want me to have anything to do with them. I should go there, if I wanted to go there, with questionnaires or interviews and tell their story my own way. It doesn't matter what they want. Hooks, the only person who writes a name with small, lowercase, is Hooks. Can somebody read for us what Hooks says about politics of the other in educational borderlands? Now we are getting to my title slowly. So educational borderlands, what are they about? Can somebody read that for us, please? Yes, please.
No need to hear your voice. Speak about yourself. Only tell me about your pain. I want to know your story, and then I will tell it back to you in a new way. Tell it back to you in a way that it's become mine, my own. Rewriting you, I rewrite myself for you. I'm still the author, authority. I'm still the colonizer, the speaker, subject, and you are now the center of my talk.
Excellent. Good reader, too. you know what? Mario, you want to do research in Tuxedo. You say the schools are not doing well, okay? There's something wrong with the schools. But what you want to know is you don't want to know from the people in the school what is really wrong. You sit in your office and make something you call objectives of your research. And you want to tell their story, it becomes yours because you're going to publish and become a publisher, a very well-noted academician, right? But Tuxedo, the people in Tuxedo don't have anything to do with your story. All you want to do is let them, if you need their story, you go to them, they tell you their story, they tell you that this is what is happening there. You write it your own way, the way you think is acceptable for the publications and also acceptable for donors and grant givers. You write it the way you want it. And that is it. This is what it's all about, educational borderlands. Tuxedo becomes an educational borderland. They are not academic, so you don't want to have anything to do with them. You can't go to the northern community because they are not like us, UBC. We are academic. They are Aboriginal people. They don't know anything. We don't need anything from them. So that is what we mean by borderlands. So I'm just trying, first of all, to... Oh, we've done this, comments. First of all, to explain the title. So the title is all about how we do research in these communities, how we regard them, and how we deal with them. Now, we are experts. My UBC people say, hey, Seth, you are an expert. Go there, forget about this participatory thing. Who are they? Native people or Aboriginal people? Who are they to work with you in your research? You're a PhD student. You're going to be called a doctor. Those people haven't been to school before. So you have to think of what you want to do there. Don't encourage them to be part of it. And then those people, they are other people. They live, they are marginal. Forget about them. So they are just to be studied. You go there, do your study, experiment, and do whatever you want to do, and get out of there. Forget about them. They need nothing from you. You don't need anything from them, except telling their story your own way. That's what you need, to hear from them. Now, so participatory research. What is it? The participatory research that I've been talking about since I started my speech a few minutes ago, and what I wanted to do since 1990, I'm talking about 1992. I was very happy that I went to Vancouver for a meeting recently, not too long ago, and Bart Hall became the dean of Victoria, University of Victoria at BC, and he's retired now. And he's one of the founders of participatory research in the 70s when he started this concept in Tanzania. So Bart Hall held me in front of the audience after his keynote speech and said, "This is the youngest participatory researcher that we have now. He is Seth Agbo." And he told my story to them. See, I was very proud about that. So I said, since then, I said, I'm going to be carrying participatory research forward because it's so important. So it's an alternative qualitative research approach. You see, not doing research for the people like we do in normal academic research, for danger, but with community people. It has three processes: research, education, and action. Three of them must be there. If the three of them are not there, then your project is not completely participatory. There must be research, education, and also action. So, Cummings, I think he was at OIG, Cummings said it's a method of research in dialogue with communities. He did some research in Australian communities and wrote a nice piece on that. And Freire describes what dialogue is. Dialogue is not depositing ideas into people, telling talk-state people, this is what you need to do because your school is not doing well. But that's for the ministry. The ministry wants to hear that. That Marion goes to do research at talk-state and then tells them that, oh, well, this is what they are supposed to do to make their schools better. That is, Freire says, that's not the way you have to do it. Participatory research is a dialogue thing. It's a dialogical. Now, we have a definition. You see, the with research with the collaboration of those affected by the issue. Talks that people say their schools are not doing well. Okay, they have to fix it. You can't fix anything for anybody, actually. From my experience working with Aboriginal communities for about 20 years now, I've learned that you can't fix anything for anybody anyway, except the people really want to fix it themselves. It must come from their heart that we want to fix this. But if anybody thinks that a school is not doing well and this is what the government has to do or people have to do for it to become better, it's never going to be. Except the people get up and understand that this is what we need to make our school a better place. So research by and with the people. And one important thing is the community knowledge should always be reflected in the project you are doing. The idea that these people are Aboriginal people, they don't know anything, and so on and so forth. If I tell you what I learned from these communities, you'll be surprised how intellectual I became after my PhD. In fact, I didn't learn anything at university as much as I learned in these communities with the elders, sitting around and discussing things with us. So you build ownership collectively, and then you see the other keeps coming. We move from creating the other to portraying the views of less powerful group. Park says, every kind of participatory research must be about empowering. That is giving the chance for people who are affected by issues to take ownership of their problems and solve them. So it's a social action process. Of course, we talked about research, education, action. Creswell also talks about that. So Park also says it's helping downtrodden people to be self-reliant. Now, we come to the question that my students usually ask me. I teach a research course, and when I tell them about participatory research, he said, so what's all this about? The most important aspects of participatory research, first of all, is the origins of the issues. I didn't want to just leave this point like that. So I went into detail to explain each one of them. So these 6 points must be well dealt with in participatory research. First of all, let's see the origins of the issues. According to participatory research, the criteria to enter into the research site, you want to go to talk stuff. You don't just get up and say, I am Mary Angels, professor at LJMU, and I am the expert in this, and I want to find out why your schools are not doing well. They say you don't do that. Or you don't say, I am here to help you to fix your school. What they say you have to do is to put yourself out to be requested. Okay, this is the question I'm going to ask the audience. How do you do that? How will Marion put herself out there to be requested by Tuxedo?
The trick.
What?
That is the trick. How do you do
it? It is very easy to do. You have to put yourself out to be requested.
Oh, look who's here.
Do you know each other, by the way?
Hello.
Yes, we have met.
Yes, we met in Dave's office. Yes, so can anybody answer that question for us? How you put yourself out to be requested? That is one of the biggest things about participatory research. You don't go in there and say, I am this LGMU professor. Yes, it's a good name, big name, but they say it's not the right thing to do. Mark, do you have any idea how you could do that?
Well, we've done some collaborative projects, and this is really hitting the nail on the head.
The difficult part.
And the only way I could perhaps perceive it to be a bit easier is if you could ask this community if there is any issues they have identified themselves that they would like to resolve or address, and if so, whether they think you could assist them in doing that.
That's a good way. Any other way you can put yourself out to be requested? That's a good way. Actually, when I was going to do my PhD research, I looked for a job, okay? But I made it clear at the interview, as I said before, that I am coming to work here on a project also in community, in school development. I said I was interested in school development project, that if I'll come only if you will assist me or help me to have this project take off. So, we want you to come. You know, I put myself forward. They say, we want you to come. We need somebody like you in the school. So putting yourself forward is not bad to show them your expertise, but not downplaying what is there in TalkSeth, not telling them their schools are not good, but letting them know that there are things you could do together. Things you could do together. This is very exciting, what I see here. And I'm interested in this too. So maybe there are things we can do together. We can work together. Or if you like, sometime I can come and give a speech to your, invite me to come and give a speech to your staff and see if there's anything we can do together. So, you know, you put yourself out to be requested by letting them know that you can work together collaboratively. That's the trick one, but it's important. And the relationships have to be negotiated with the wishes of the local inhabitants. I'm not going to force myself onto them. They have to actually want me.
What just been whispered over here is, does that present any ethical issues, Seth? Because if you are there to study things, and you haven't told them that you're there to study things, then you're not being honest in what you're trying to achieve, are you?
Exactly.
So are there certain things you need to do to make sure you are being honest?
Well, yeah. In my case, when I was doing my PhD project, and then I wanted to work in the Aboriginal community for 3 years, I first looked for a job. But I did tell them that I wanted, it was part of my project too, at the university. I did tell them that. But then, after the university, okay, now I had a grant, $211,000 grant, that I did this project I'm going to show you in a few minutes. And that project, I wrote the proposal, but before I wrote the proposal, I started working with the Aboriginal communities at conferences. They used to have conferences, and I would send in abstract to make presentations. Then they used to call me for keynote speeches once in a while. That was a good presentation he made. Let's bring him here for keynote. Then when it was time for me to apply for the grant, I said, hey, can we work together on this project? I see that you have been doing some work in this area. So if we can work together, so I'm going to put in the proposal, and if you can ask your chiefs, for example, the project I'm going to talk about is that, maybe I should start that because this is a good conversation. The project I'm going to talk about is that in Canada, the Aboriginal communities have schools up to the 8th year, grade 8, and then they have to send their kids to the big cities like Thunder Bay and Winnipeg and other places. But these kids are too young to be on their own in the cities. So what happens is they take to drugs and other things, and then they don't complete school. Some of them get pregnant, the girls, all kinds of things. So it's very hard for them to complete high school or secondary school. So what happened was a few of the community members, chiefs, 16 communities, as is my abstract, got up and said, let us now find a way of educating our kids at home and giving them the proper education. And the idea came that, we can have an internet high school and let people teach these kids from big cities on the internet. But let's have a classroom for them. And then we have teachers teaching different subjects, specialists. But the teachers in the classrooms will supervise their work, their assignments and other things. They are not the teachers. They are just resident type of teachers. So I heard about this idea. So I went to them and said, hey, I heard that you are trying to do this. Can we work together? I'm interested in this project. See how it went. They said, okay, I said, we can apply for a government loan. And luckily I put in the loan application and we got the loan. We applied for $250,000 and we got $211,000 to do the project. So we finished it last year. That's what I'm going to talk about. So you need to come forward and tell them exactly what you want to do. But if you don't, the communities, if you don't go to them somehow, put yourself out to be requested. They are never going to want your help. If you don't go to talk state and talk to them about your capabilities or how you can help them do something or work with them. Work with them, that's the point. Okay, so where are we now? So functions of university researcher and community, that's the second one. The first one is the origin of the issues that you're going to deal with. The second one is, what are you going to do? Both the university researcher, Marion, and TalkSet people should decide on which groups will be working in the project. They have to decide. Marion will not sit in her office and say, this is my project proposal. I'm going to do this and do that and do that. No, that's not it. They have to meet together and say, who is going to take part in this project? And if there are university people going to take part, is Dave going to be on board? The meeting must let everybody know that Dave, Mark, and others are going to be on board. And these are the community people too that are going to be on board. Okay, so you have to determine what to stop people from actually being part of the project. All of you have to meet and discuss that. I heard you had so many meetings today. One of those could be that kind of meeting. The university researcher community design strategy for sustained participation. How do you make people continue to participate in the project? That's a big one. It's not easy. You know what we did? I found out that we could use part of the research money, the grant money, to pay them $100 every time we met for a workshop. We used to have workshops. So we paid every community member that came $100 a day. And that was a lot of money. I mean, it was expensive to do that, but that was the only way at the point that we could actually have the participation, sustain the participation. So you develop project plans and training relevant skills. You know what we also did in our project? We had community researchers. If you don't have community researchers in a participatory research project, you may not be able to complete what you want to do. You must train the people on site to do the work for you, instead of you going there with your graduate students or whoever and doing that alone. So that is important, to train the community participants themselves. Then, is your work with TalkSet, is it building, giving capacity, is it capacity building? Is it using community knowledge and resources, or you just bring LGMU knowledge, academic knowledge to the community, telling them everything? No, you have to use your resources. So you have to learn about how to collaborate. Are you flexible? All these things must be learned during the process of collaboration. Now, then power relations. This is the biggie about participatory research. See, my professors at UBC wanted me to have power when I went to the Aboriginal community. That's why they said, we don't do this kind of thing at UBC. What we do here is basic research. Basic. You have power over everything that you are doing. So you don't. So you see, the power relations is a big thing, because a lot of times I was a backbencher. I just listened and learned. And things, I didn't agree with everything that the community wanted us to do, but that was their community. They were the people who were to fix the school problem. So if that's what they deemed fit, we went with it. I just had to document that. Now, so this power thing, we both, all of you are going to share power, and you are going to respect each of their traditions. Let me give you an example of respecting the traditions. You go to a community, you fly your students there. I used to have two PhD students. We flew from Thunder Bay to a place called Fort Seven, for example. I had 16 communities, but we chose eight of them. We flew to Fort Seven, far up north, and three of us paid about $6,000 flying in there. $6,000 to fly in there, because I'll show you the type of planes we were using. So you know what happened. You go there and they say, oh, sorry, you can't do anything here today. You can't do anything here today. Why? Oh, we have a problem in the community, and we are not in the mood for this kind of thing this time. So goodbye. We'll see you another time. Say, my goodness, $6,000 just gone in the drain. I put the hotel in the place. Their hotels are $200 a night because we who go there must pay them there. So we have a lot of problems. We slept for $200 a night and then went on the plane again the next morning and went back. And we would go back another test. Oh, somebody died last night. Sorry. There's a death in the community. You can't do anything here. Bye-bye. So this is what happened. I mean, we have to respect all these things. We didn't complain. We felt it, but we said, okay, what can we do? We have to, and I didn't give up. We kept going. One important aspect also is, are you learning together with the community? It's very important. Whether you are doing some learning together, and whether the project is with research, education, action, like we said before. How do you bring the participants' intellectual resources together? This is very important. I didn't used to know that Aboriginal people who never went to school were so knowledgeable until recently. They were so knowledgeable. They have their own epistemology, which in fact, I've written some articles which in fact made me feel that these people are even better than most of us in universities when it comes to thinking about issues that matter to them, that we want to research for them. So it's important for you to harness all of this together. And then, one thing we made sure was that we didn't tell them, oh, we have computers or old typewriters, old something we are going to give you. If I used a new Mac and I wanted them to have a computer, they got a brand new one too. So they were abreast with technology and everything. And everything that we had in the university, they had the equivalent in the community to use. We didn't downplay them at all. That because they were in the community, they could use old printers and old computers. We didn't do that. We gave them the up-to-date, the state-of-the-art of everything. Now, how are we doing with time, Mariam? Not bad?
I've got 5 o'clock.
Excellent. So the production of knowledge, is it linked to action? You know what? One of the questions they used to ask me when I used to present my PhD thesis for a job. Oh, I didn't tell you about my job yet. When I finished UBC, my first job was at State University of New York in Potsdam. I was there for 3 years as a assistant professor. Then I got another job in Portland, Oregon. I was there for 4 years as the director of the teacher education program before I came to Canada, where I did my master's. So I'm teaching where I did my master's now. After 15 years, I came back to Lakehead University. So anytime I went for an interview after my PhD with that, my participatory research thing, the question that people asked me was a question of validity. They asked me, you did participatory research. Can you tell us about the validity of your research? And I used to answer, that doesn't apply to my research. My research, okay. Then, as time went on, in my literature review, before I did this, I came across Party Leather, University of Georgia or somewhere. Party Leather writes on methodologies. And Party Leather coined the term catalytic validity. And she was writing about participatory research between the rock and the hard place. She wrote an article. And she said catalytic validity can happen in participatory research only if there is action after the project. So the action part makes it brings the validity in it. So Jim Cummings, for example, in his report of my thesis said it clearly, there was clearly catalytic validity in this project, which means there was action. People did what they were supposed to do. So that's important, the action part of the project. You can stop me and ask me any question. So all we are talking about is about participatory research approach. I've been talking too much. What's your name, my friend?
I'm Grant.
Oh, please read the first bullet for me.
The first one.
Yes.
Develops intercultural relations that advantage neither party and protect the interest of both the university-based researcher and the community.
Yes. That is what it does. When Marion goes to Tuxedo, both of you are equal. Power relations. It helps, it protects both your interests, the community and the university interests. Not only the community, but the university interests too. So then the power relations too. You see, this is important, an agreement of equals. It's not easy to trade power. Universities don't like to trade power. Yes, a good question.
The question that occurs to me, when you did your PhD, if you were also the principal, and therefore in a power relationship presumably within an organization, how can you, as it were, square the rhetoric of agreement of equals with that hierarchical position?
That's an excellent question. You came up at my defense, as if you were there. You know, by the issue about that principalship in the communities is different from the principalship in places like here. There, you can be asked to pack your things and leave tomorrow morning by just a little thing that you do. So they have a lot of power over both teachers. 95% of teachers in Aboriginal communities are white teachers. They don't have their own people teaching. And for that reason, colonialism that used to be thought of, the colonial aspect of the white people suppressing Aboriginals, is so fresh on the minds of the present generation in Aboriginal communities because of residential schools, some kind of schools that they had before. So they have so much power. We principals were just pawns. We were just pawns in the communities. So that would sound as if principal, I had power, but I didn't actually have a lot of power. What I had was to listen to the people. In fact, it made me, the only thing that the principalship did for me was to give me inroads into the collaborative work with the community. But there was no way a black Ghanaian could go into that community in any way to do anything there without actually having that kind of position. And then I had to behave myself properly too, even with that position, yes.
Do you think that it was an advantage that you were a black Ghanaian? If you had been a white Canadian, do you think it would have been different?
Why are you asking me questions that way? Actually, my defense, several years ago, my defense was on December 20, 1995. That question was there. The question, okay, it would have been different in the sense that, okay, there is a hierarchy according to their minds, the Aboriginal people. Somebody told me a story that when God was making human beings, God first baked the white person and took the white out of the oven so fast, not well baked. And then said, okay, let me bake the next one and see how good it will be. Put the black person in and God didn't look at the time. And then before God brought the black person out, he said, oh, too baked, it's burnt. So now I have to take my time and sit down and bake a right human being. So they baked the Aboriginal people, and that was the perfect color God wanted of people. So God removed the Aboriginal person from the oven and found out, yes, this is the red color I want of humans. That's what the story I was told by an Aboriginal person in the community I was working, which means there's a hierarchy of the fact that white were up there, white, well, not well-baked. Black people, you bent, we were bent. And Aboriginal people are right. So they looked at me as being in the same category with them, with the colonialism that is going on, even though they are the right people. And they see that we have the same struggles. So they might have treated me better than they would treat a white Canadian. That is true. The relationships were good and better. Yes. Okay. So those are good questions. Now, I bring you to the research I did up now, details of the research. Background of the study. I started the background already by telling you that these are 16 communities that said we cannot continue to let our kids fail school because none of the kids were completing high school. They were sent after grade 8 to the big cities. And many of them, the girls became pregnant, the boys became drunkards, they were alcoholic. And at the age of 13, how could you leave these kids take them out of the community? So the community said, okay, you know what you're going to do? You're going to have an internet high school. And I heard this. So I went and I told them we could work together, put myself to be requested by them, and I wrote the grant application, which was accepted, and we had the money. So we were between Lake, this is Lakehead University. This is how it actually looks most of the time, for 8 months. Okay, this is the research community. This is how they looked at the Aboriginal community. That's me going on the plane, 14-seater. You can only reach this community by air. You can only reach the community. You see the kind of terrain you fly through to the communities that we're working at. Okay, that's how the communities look like. That was a PhD student I was working with. And this is River 7. We are in 47, actually. This is the river in the winter. And this is one of the communities too we were working in. That's how the place looks like. It's only a flying community, but there are vehicles there. You can't drive in there. Okay, this is the internet high school. One of the internet high schools, which means that the high school teachers should be in a central location. If you're a math teacher, Mark, you'll be in this school. I'll be teaching math to all the 16 schools. So there'll be only one teacher in the community, and then that teacher would broadcast to the rest of the schools. But the schools have to be there from 9 to 4. So what is happening is that, what is happening is that, these are the people from the community that I want to show you, the participatory research group. You won't find me in the picture because I was taking the pictures. I felt bad that I should have not been taking the picture because I want to see myself there. And these are people who are elders. Some of them have never been to school. Some of them are teachers in the school. Some of them are nurses. Some of them are community workers. Some of them are bank office workers. That's an elder of the community. And we all sit down to discuss. We put the issues on the table. What do you want your students to learn at the internet high school? We list the questions and we discuss these issues one by one. And one of the biggest findings, okay, this is where somebody who really wants to become very academic and doesn't want to talk about participatory research to play around. So the graduate students and I said, with all these things we've been doing, what did we learn from the community, the Aboriginal community? So we put our heads together and started drawing diagrams. Now how can we present this in a holistic diagram that will look complex so that our participatory research becomes academic and very academic indeed? So we came up with this, we came up with a few diagrams, figures, and luckily, the professor himself, I came up with this, and my student said, "You are indeed the professor. Explain it, let's see." Okay, so the idea is that we're trying to see, first of all, we had very many findings from our research, but the most important finding was called the education situation. That is the most important. How is education in these communities? That's what we wanted to find out about. And we found out that the education situation could be represented in this diagram in something we call the conformity and rationality modules. And the conformity and rationality modules are being policed by the rationality module is being policed by Aboriginal people. This area being policed by Aboriginal people and people who are interested in Aboriginal scholars like me and others. We are policing this part of the rationality module. Then this conformity module is being policed by the Canadian government. An Eurocentric education, which simply is saying that the education in Aboriginal communities is being pulled by two forces. The first force is cultural education, Aboriginal stuff. Do they really want to continue learning Aboriginal stuff? Some of them will say, yes, we want to continue learning Aboriginal stuff. But those who have forgotten about the Aboriginal experience under what they call colonialism, they say, no, we don't want to continue learning Aboriginal stuff. We want Eurocentric stuff. We want our kids to be like the Canadian kids in Toronto and Vancouver and Calgary. We don't want our kids to be only Aboriginal. But some others, especially the Christians, the Christians in Aboriginal communities will be moving towards, this is the arrow that we found out in the research. The Christians in the community thought that a lot of Aboriginal things are evil. They are not, because they have a lot of, how many of you have been to North America before? North America. Oh, good. Canada? Or.
Not Canada.
No. America?
Yeah,
US.
To some Pueblo Indian areas, so First Nation areas, but in US.
Oh, okay. Have you seen a First Nation person before?
Yes.
The Aboriginal people?
Yes.
How many of you have seen Aboriginal people in Canada?
Canada.
Where?
In Australia.
Australia. Good. And you have been to Canada?
Not to Canada,
no,
to the US.
Congo.
US.
Really? Congleton is the First Nation.
Just imagine you sitting there controlling the internet.
Hey, that's interesting. Okay, so the Aboriginal people, as we see them, they have different names. In America, they call them Native Americans. They accept that universally in America. In Canada, it's very difficult to know what we should call them. We sometimes call the Aboriginal people, but their choice of term is First Nations. That's their choice of term. But because I'm making this, if I were making this presentation in Canada, I would put Aboriginal in bracket. Because they would prefer First Nations to Aboriginal or Native. Native. Oh, sorry. All right. So they prefer Aboriginal to, they prefer First Nations to Native. Okay, so what is happening here is that when you go into these communities for research, you find out that they are divided. They are different kinds. They are divided. Those who are younger, they are on this side. rationality. They want their people to know Aboriginal stuff. The younger people, surprisingly, they want their people to know Aboriginal stuff. They want those in the 40s, 30s, 40s, they want their culture. They want to be taught the culture and the traditions and other things. But those who are older, some of them who had been to something called residential schools in the old days, they have forgotten the residential school experience. They found it rather refreshing to have learned the Eurocentric stuff. And they think their present generation is not learning much of the Eurocentric stuff. So they view the Aboriginal stuff like powwow. Powwow, some kind of traditional traditions they have, Somaji and other things, they view them as evil. And of course, most of these communities are Catholic communities, and some of them are Protestant. And those Christians will be moving towards here, to this side. And these ones are usually people like us, Jim Cummings, and people who have been academics, who have been writing about Aboriginal education. They want to move towards this side. But what we really found was that the gray area represents what really actually happens in Aboriginal communities. That is, the education situation is bicultural education. The teachers are struggling hard to keep up with Aboriginal culture, if they could. But the problem with the gray area is that we are not training the teachers in Canada to be in these communities. We are not training them for those communities. Actually, I developed a course called Teaching in Isolated Communities. I taught it for 3 years, and I used to take the students to the communities. We flew there, and we drove there because we couldn't fly. It was too expensive. So we found the nearest driving communities and went there. Even that was, you know, this cut thing they do, cutting things. They're cutting everything, everywhere. So they cut that trip that we used to make, and I said, no, I'm not going to teach this course again, if they will cut everything. So we don't educate these kids, our students, well enough to be in this gray area. They are just managing to be there. But that is the education situation. They say, if you talk to the communities, those pictures you saw, those discussions we're having, this is the outcome, bicultural education. That's what they say they want. And it is acceptable that this is in the gray area here, but how much, the problem is, how much of which is not clear. So it's a big problem. And the Canadian government is not going to say Aboriginal students should do different exams anyway, if there are exams. And it's not going to say that Aboriginal students are well qualified if they study their own culture. So they are looking forward to seeing the Aboriginal students do the Canadian curriculum, pushing it into the Aboriginal communities, and then it's not working for them. And the teachers who are teaching these kids to are not Aboriginal. 95% of all the teachers in Aboriginal communities are white. So the education situation is very murky. It's not clear at all. It's not as good as we might be thinking it is. The internet high school that we studied comparatively is doing well because we've had students go to university from the internet high school. It started only a few years ago. And these students are actually having something we call 300% education, in the sense that some of these students in their classes find their teachers not able to manipulate technology, and they walk from their seats because they have been with these things in their communities. That's all they know, computers. So they walk from their seats and help the teachers, which is very impressive. And then they live in their communities also to grow up there to know the culture. And then they learn the Canadian stuff too. So we call it 300% education for our internet high school. But we have we still have problems with the internet high school. We need to work on it better than it is now. But it is an eye-opener to depressed areas around the world that the students still, with this communication age, technology age, students can have the best even though they are not there physically. So that's the idea about our internet high school. Yeah, so actually the last slide is just to say thank you for coming. As I said, it is a very ungodly hour for you to come here. And I'm glad that you came. And so the last thing I put there is to ask you to ask me questions, because I have so much to say and I can continue talking forever.
Could it be argued that in an environment with climate change, environmental change, the Aboriginal culture has to change, and therefore the traditional values and lifestyles are changing? They have to, they've changed already, and therefore it's becoming less important, and everybody's going to be shifting towards the left of your diagram.
Yeah, okay.
With time, 50 years' time,
yeah.
You know, with oil and with so forth in the Canadian Arctic, they're not going to want to have the lifestyle that they had 100 years ago.
Yes, this is a very good point, but most writers now are advocating that if we want to keep the planet, that we should involve the Aboriginal epistemology, the ideologies, for us to respect the land, because this is the big thing. The things they profess is to respect the land and do all those things. So writers are saying that we better go back to Aboriginals to teach us what to do instead of polluting our mother.
Yeah, but the Aboriginal culture is now in a situation, an environmental situation, that they haven't been in.
Yeah.
Not for probably, I don't know, 15,000 years.
Yes.
So they're adapting and changing continuously now. They have to.
But don't forget that these communities I'm talking about are all fly-in, isolated communities. Fly-in. It's not easy to get there. Even if you get there, you must pay a lot of money to get there by flying. So it's not, the places are not open easily. They get everything that we have, almost everything but junk food, yes, and everything, but actually they are not very open. Several of them are about hundreds and hundreds of miles from the nearest city. Thunder Bay services 49 Aboriginal communities. Thunder Bay is the only Canadian city 700 kilometers radius. Apart from the next city is Winnipeg, so which is 700 kilometers from Thunder Bay. And then most of the Aboriginal communities are clustered around that area. So a lot of them are not changing because of their isolation. That is a problem.
Well, they're changing because of internet education, because of globalization, everything.
Now,
so are they going to want to maintain that culture?
Good. That was our research. That was our research. Now, what do you want? Now that you have internet education, you have technology, what do you really want? That was the question for the research, for the Aboriginal people. How do you want your education to be like? How do you want your community to look like after several years? What do you need your kids to do or learn at school? That was the research we did. And that's why we came to that middle point, which is the bicultural education. They want their kids to learn the Eurocentric stuff and also their stuff. And in fact, some of them in the write-ups, some of them said, our kids have to be lawyers to fight land claims for us. When you interview them, they say they need land claims. They need a lot of claims from the government. So we need doctors, we need lawyers. So we can't say we are going to keep to our Aboriginal culture. We need to make our kids Eurocentric as much as they can be.
But yes. You
present their answers always as being either one or the other. As far as I understand from you, you haven't talked about overlap and negotiated meaning or something, you know, like a third culture or an interculture. You've just talked about something that's bilateral.
Oh, that's a good point. Actually, if you read our write-up, it's in there that they want intercultural knowledge. What do you mean by intercultural? You mean Aboriginal and other Aboriginal groups?
It's about seeing things from two different perspectives. So it's about seeing the other perspective from their perspective and creating a new meaning from that way of looking at things.
Yes. The local Aboriginal people, they usually look back to when they were growing up, rather than look forward and see what is happening. Since they've remained in the communities, they are not in the cities. If they were in the cities, they would have a different perspective of putting things together. But the older people, they are able to only talk about the past and warn their kids. Those who are not Christians, those who are Christians, they don't want their kids to be cultural. They want their kids to move ahead on the Eurocentric side. So, but the younger people do what you are talking about. They put things together because they are with the internet. They have cell phones in the communities. They have radios and TVs and everything. So they do what you are talking about, the younger generation.
Why is that? I mean, you'd expect it to be exactly the reverse, that the younger generation would want to go left on your diagram.
Yes.
Because they've got all these things. They've got globalization of everything.
Yes.
What's the real reason why they want to go further to the right?
Not the very young ones. Those who have been, who have seen discrimination in the job market and all the other things that go with discrimination as Aboriginal person. They are revolutionary, that we need to perpetuate ourselves. We need to show the world that we are somebody, that we have values that people have not been recognizing. So these are the 30, 40-year-olds who maybe have tried to find a job somewhere, they can find it, and they have been their esteem has been going down because they have not been able to show themselves that they are worthy of being capable of being what the other people are.
Is that also because they're not religious like the other generation?
They are not, yeah.
Yeah, so is that what it is?
That could be too, yeah. But that is the point, that they want to be Aboriginal, have something Aboriginal about them, because what they are now is not working for them.
It's about identity, yeah, isn't it?
Identity.
Identity, yeah.
Identity, that's the point. Identity, yes.
Do you draw much on the African experience of decolonization and the promotion of notions of African socialism and participatory democracy that Nariri and people like that espoused? I mean, has that influenced you in your reading of these peoples and in the construction of that kind of polar diagram?
Comparing this with the African situation, you mean? Well, I tried to think through it some time ago, but it's different because having been in Aboriginal communities for some time, I saw that in the African situation, we see the good life. We see the good life clearly as being Eurocentric. We saw it clearly. And that, somebody asked me a question today about Aboriginals, that do they have the opportunity to go to school? If you're in Canada, you are Aboriginal, the sky is the limit. You can, if you decide to do PhD today, as a baby, you do it, you just have it and do it. But the problem we are having is that motivation of getting them there is not about money, it's not about capability, it's not about anything, but the idea of they finding it necessary for them to see that education is part of the good life, that is the difference in Africa. We see education as part of the good life. In fact, the colonialists, the British were in a nice bungalows that when they were leaving, left behind. And so we saw that when the British, for example, were in Ghana, they had cars in their bungalows before they went there, and they had boys' quarters larger than the homes in which people live here. Boys' quarters in all the parts of Ghana, bungalows with boys' quarters. And when you finish university then, like my elder brother, you just walk into a bungalow, a government bungalow, with a Peugeot car, brand new, waiting in the bungalow with a driver and with servants. That's how it used to be when we were growing up. So we saw education as a big thing, as bringing us the good life. So we are very motivated in Africa to go to school if the opportunity is there. But on the contrary, in Aboriginal communities, it has not been the case. The people say it's because of the what they call the residential schools. They were forced into school, boarding school. They call them residential schools. And there were a lot of atrocities meted onto them during this era of boarding schools. And because of that, people really see education not being an asset, but downplaying the human being. So that is the difference between the African experience and that of the Aboriginal experience.
I would like to thank Seth Agbo for this very thought-provoking presentation. That stimulated quite a bit of discussion, and I must say it resonated with an awful lot of the challenges Grant and I encountered when we did action research with schools. So thank you very, very much.